Okay, so next up, Zunjie on React Native.
Okay. Hello, everybody. My name is Zunjie. Brief introduction of myself. I was previously working as a teaching assistant in General Assembly for the Web Development Immersive. Okay, so today I will present on building a tic-tac-toe with React Native and Socket.io. Okay. The reason why I want to present this is because during my course of training in the General Assembly, the first modules or the first project the students have submitted is tic-tac-toe. But at the point of time, they didn't have any knowledge of React or any other more knowledgeable sort of programming skill sets. So as the course progresses, we at the last modules, we decided to learn AngularJS and ReactJS. So I was in charge of the ReactJS. And slowly after that, I decided to proceed with React Native and try to build a tic-tac-toe based on React Native and Socket.io. Okay, before I delve into code base, let me show you the demo. Okay, it's actually nothing fanciful. Just like that. Okay. So the player 1 creates a game room with this code given, and player 2 will insert this code. So once the player 2 has joined the game, they can start the game already. So first player will start with the X, and then second player O. Then go on and proceed. Yep, and then player 1 wins. Okay, so that's it for the demo. Yeah. Okay. Thing is that for React Native, right, it's not as there's always a learning curve in new languages, including even like Golang, even for newbie will be like JavaScript, all this. Thing is that for ReactJS, the learning curve is actually steep, but at the point of time after that, you won't be so hard after that. Okay. But anyway, okay, forget that. Okay, to explain more about how I build out a tic-tac-toe, right? In ReactJS, it's made of components. So for React Native, it's the same thing. It's made of all the components. So there's a wrapper called the index.ios.js, and then after that, the internal will be the board. The board itself will contain the tiles, each individual tiles of the grid, which contain the S or O or empty string mark. Okay, so each of these components have their own various responsibilities. So for the index, they do the socket connection initiation, creating a room and joining a room. And for the board, you'll be updating a board state, rendering a tiles, and then toggling the player turn. Listening for the player turn. And then finally, the tile will be rendering the S or the O, and then also emitting click event on server. Okay, to focus more on the React Native, right? Before you start programming on React Native, you need to install three various packages. So particularly for macOS, you need to install the Node, Watchman, and the React Native CLI. These three are required in order to create the React Native app. And in order to communicate to the server, you need to install the Socket.io client, which is this line. Okay, so what is a simple navigation app? The simple navigation app is actually what you saw just now during the transition. Yeah, this is a navigation. Every time, if the two player has already initiated the game, then the navigator will be in charge of propagating the new scene on top, right, and pushing on top. So it's defined by here. Switch route ID case 1 and return the tic-tac-toe app. The tic-tac-toe app will be this whole layout, which is done in here. Yeah, which is under a render method in this whole code. Okay, so for the React Native, the life cycle will be something like, if I remember correctly, right, is the constructor, then the component will mount, render, and component deep mount. There are some other methods that I didn't invoke, but this is the general gist of it. Okay, so for constructor, right, I need to set the initial state, which the create empty code, join code, player, and then navigator. And then I need to bind all the functions to this component instance. In the case, then for following that in the component will mount, right, I'll actually initiate a socket connection to the server. Okay, this is a bit messy, but okay, yeah, here's the part that is quite interesting. Notice the touchable without feedback on press, then you invoke this function called dismiss keyboard, and the dismiss keyboard will blur our input. The reason is because if I don't do this, let's say like that, okay, toggle, notice that the keyboard don't disappear if I click somewhere else. You need to blur out, and it will work the same, it will produce the same mistake if you deploy it on the actual phone, actual device. So that's why you need to blur out whenever I click on somewhere else. Maybe something. Yeah, something like this. So for all the rest of clickable buttons, such as the create game room and join room, will be bounded by, will be enclosed by a touchable highlight. This will signify that this particular component has a touch event. Okay, following that, moving forward, going to the board.js, which I mentioned that has two responsibilities. One is updating on game board, and one is the rendering of tiles. Okay, so for the updating of RAM board over here, same. We are returning the board update and then setting a state. Once the server will emit the board update through the socket, and then once the React Native app receives it, you update the game board based on data received. And then also we'll receive whose player turn is it. As for rendering part, this is something that's quite strong. So actually it's just a nested mapping. I map the row and then I map the column after that, which is based from here. So every time I update, because what the server will send is actually the whole game board. This game board. Some, depending on the game state, you will something like this. So every time, right, once I update the game board, React Native will actually call the render function again, which will invoke this function, and then render out the appropriate values for each of the tiles. Okay, now we go deeper into the fine level, which is the tile.js. The tile.js only just render out the S or the O, and then also emit the click event to the server. So as I thought, there's a touchable highlight, and also whenever I click or emit the click, we should contain the game code, the specific row and the column of the grid, and also the value. Let me see. Oh yeah, for the box.js, right, notice that there's a player name and the player turn. The reason why I need to have this is because I need each of the player, right, is either player 1 or player 2, but I need to tell the both of them whose player turn is it. So from here, from the tile.js, I'll be able to know, is that player able to make a mark on the grid or not. Okay. Oh yeah, how the random code generator is actually pretty quite complex. I'm not sure why, but I can't create a random number from 0 to 9999, and then the app will crash or freeze frequently. Therefore, the workaround is I will create 4 random digits, and then after that I concat them together, which will produce a 4-digit code, as shown here. pre-stage freeze fire, yeah. And then after that, once I create a game code, I will emit the gray room event to the server. Yeah. And then, in the server side, you create the gamebox store. So the overview of gamebox store will be something like this. Gamebox store is an object whereby it contains various key values. The key will be the game code. The value will be is another object, which is the gamebox. The gamebox is a 3x3 array. Following that, the player 1 and player 2 socket ID. And also, after that, lastly, will be the player turn itself. Initially, I didn't do that. So, because I didn't really cater for multiplayer, multi-game running at the same time. So what I do is, instead of emitting to a... I need this function. Initially I didn't do this, instead I did this broadcast. Something like that, broadcast.emit. This will emit to all, but this won't work if there are multiple games running at the same time. Finally, so that's why I need to change this io.in. Emit to the two players, which is binded by the room code. So if for these two players, right, only they will, if one player one emit, then player one and player two in the game room will receive the event. Yeah, the reset bot I haven't do yet. Okay. The thing about React Native is that they let you learn once, write anywhere. So that's also, I would think that so quite a bad point, because you have to write one for the in-depth iOS or JS, and another one for the index or android.js, which I never write for the Android. And also, for those who have done React.js, right, you understand that you can only render one root node. Something like all these two things. Like this view. And inside of that will be all the various components inside. Because how JS sets compile will be something like this. React.create class. Something like this. So if you are trying to return two root nodes, right, you create two return functions at the same time, which don't make any sense in the syntax. That's why you have to write one root node only. Another key point to take note of React Native is that you can use CSS to style the components. Something like this. But they introduce new variables such as flats and justify content. Yeah, that's all I will use. And the difference is that usually in CSS, right, you do like this background color. But notice that for React, you have to do a camel casing instead of a slug case. Anyway, last but not least, these are all the reference links that I took from in learning how to do React Native and the socket IO. Finally, here's my GitHub repo and demo video. If you guys didn't see the demo, you can see it. Take a look at the demo here. Should be here. Yeah, it's actually the same thing. I'll show you guys. Yeah, I think that's all. Any questions? Or any feedbacks?
I think the React Native is still very honest version. So, do you think it's stabilized enough to use in real production application?
that depends on what kind of features are you trying to make use of. For example, if you're trying to make use of Apple Pay or Google Wallet, I wouldn't advise it. But if you're trying to render such very basic viewing of items or even shopping carts, then maybe it's okay for it to go into production.
So do you, how many percentage does it cover the APIs from iOS and Android?
For now, I haven't really researched in all the various components that React Native can use, but so far I think around 70%, 50 to 70%, yes. I cannot really judge because I didn't really use all the components. Yeah.
Any more questions for Zhenjie?
Would it make any sense to write an app
in React Native that was also a website? Would you recommend that, or is that a silly idea?
I can say something about that. It's going to be a good idea soon.
Can you tell us why? Okay, can you tell us why?
I mean, so Facebook in California does a cool thing every first Wednesday a month, which is called React Wednesdays, and they invite a bunch of React people into their office, and we work with staff at Facebook on React Native and other things, and they ask for feedback and all this stuff. And already in March, they were had started to work on like tools and components that can make React Native apps web apps. So that will come eventually.
What's already what I'm doing is I create three components: an iOS component, an Android component, and a web component. React, normal React components in React Native. So then I use Redux, and I'm also familiar with Redux. Redux manages all the logic of three components. That's another thing. And you have some library called React Native for Web, which compiles the React Native to normal React components. So that's also already possible.
Yeah.
So yeah, but you have to think about the user experience. Like on web and on mobile apps, it's not the same thing. Mm-hmm. So you need to be really good at it. But you're trying to use it for
Mesh.
Yeah, you gave it to the question.